This time, we will cover how we can change the variables of the material in the script. Today's example will use materials used in the test cube and character. The test cube uses standard shader. Other options other than the albedo texture are used as they are by default. The shader used for the character is using an individually created custom shader. Now, let's create a new script file and apply it to the game object named Manager Material. To access the materials variables, we first need to get the renderer component. Since there are two game objects used in the scene, I will create two renderer variables. Next, I will create two public game object variables. Let's apply each game object to the two declared game objects. Now, let's write the code that gets the two renderer components. Now we have imported the renderer component, we can now access the material. Now, let's make the cube's texture replace at runtime. First, I will prepare an image to replace the texture of the cube. I will select one of the textures in the folder and apply it to the cube's main texture. The format of the variable should be texture2D. I will apply the image to be replaced to the declared texture2D variable. To apply a texture to the material, you can use the set texture command. Next, we need to enter the property or variable name of the material. The albedo texture of the standard shader uses the variable name _main_tex. Then add the texture variable and the code is done. When I run the game, we can see that the texture of the cube has been replaced. Next, we will change the texture color at runtime. First, let's create a color variable and apply color to the variable. To change the color, we need to use the setColor command. Main text's color uses the underscore color variable. The texture replacement code will be commented out to make it easier to see the color change. When I run the game, we can see that color values are applied to the material. This time, I want to turn the cube like metal. It is confirmed that the value to change like metal is of type float. If so, we should use the set float command to change the value of the variable. The variable name is underscore metallic. You can see that the metallic value is applied exactly as 0.7. Next, let's create code that turns on the function of the self-emitting emission and changes its color. To enable the toggle of a specific variable in the shader, use the command enable keyword. Note that the variable is underscore emission, and capital letters are used. To apply the emission color, use the underscore emission color variable. When I run the game, we can see that the emission function is activated and the color has changed. This can be used to create an effect that expresses when an object is damaged. Let's create two public methods to operate via a button. I will apply white to one method and black to the other. I will activate the separately prepared button and add an event trigger component to the button. Let's add the pointer down and pointer up trigger events. This will return the value of the pressed and released button. I will add the methods to each event I just created. It is confirmed the cube flashes when I click the button. This time, let's create a code that changes the tile values of the texture. To change the tile, make sure that wrap mode is set to repeat in the image import setting. To change the texture tiles, use the set texture scale command. Since the main texture is used, the variable name is also underscore main text. The tile is changed by adjusting the x and y values, so we need to use a variable of type vector2. It is confirmed that the texture has been repeated. This time, let's create a code that changes the texture offset. The syntax is similar to the code for changing the tile value of a texture. However, you can use set texture offset for the command. We can see the result of moving the texture of the cube. The names of the variables to be modified in the material can easily be determined by looking at the shader code. You can see that the variables accessed in the C# script were using the shader property names. The type of each property is detailed, so all you have to do is change the value accordingly. This standard shader code cannot be generated in Unity, so please download the code from the webpage in the description of the video. Now that we have seen the various variable changes of materials, I will show you a little applied technique. As mentioned earlier, the material applied to the character's meshes using a custom shader. Looking at the shader code, the property for changing the texture is also using the name underscore main text. There are no rules for naming properties in custom shaders. If possible, it is recommended to use the property names used in the standard shader as they are. Back in Unity, there are separate folders in the Resources folder, and there are three characters textures. Let's create a function that sequentially changes the texture of the character when the game is running. First, I will create an array variable to store three textures. In the previous process, we used texture2d as the variable type to store the texture, but this time, we will create a variable of type object. Next, I will save the path of the folder where the textures are stored in a variable of type string. Unity automatically recognizes the resources folder, so you only need to write the folder name under it. Resources load all command loads all files in the specified folder. However, we only need a texture2d file, so if you specify the type, only the file of that type is loaded and stored in a variable sequentially. When I run the game, we will see that all texture images in the folder are saved in a variable. Next, I will create a separate public method. First, I'll create a code to apply the texture. Since I used an array variable, I will create an integer variable to access the array's index. If the object variable is used as it is in the process of applying the texture following the property, a syntax error occurs because the format is incorrect. We can fix the problem by adding a type before the variable. Let's add a condition this time. If the number of declared text ID is less than the length of text player, I will increase the text ID variable by 1. If it is larger than the text player length, I will initialize the integer variable to 0. Back in the Unity editor, let's apply the method to the pre-made button. When I run the game and press the button, we can see that the character's texture changes sequentially. That's all for today's video. Thank you. See you next time.